Let's start by downloading it first and then installing it. Let's check the README file. In order to install it, we can make a dev package with this script, dev.sh. It has built this Debian package, ew.dev, and we can install it with this command, apt install, with the option F first, which will install dependencies as well. And we need to specify the path to the package. So it is installing dependencies as well, like image magic, QR encode, tree, etc. So this is the help. First of all, we can start by typing pw. It starts by creating a new archive, which is named by default pw.ptz in this directory, .pw. And it is requesting a new password for this new archive that it is being created. Type again the password. Now we are in the prompt of the password manager, and these are some of the commands that we can use. For example, list, get, show, etc. So the command set accepts the password for a password entry or a password file. For example, if the password entry is a test, we can say set test, and it will ask for the password. Another one. Now we can try ls again, yes, and we see there are two entries, test and test one. We can use get test two, for example, and it shows the password that is saved in this password entry. Or we can also use the command show. It's almost the same. Now we can also categorize these password entries in directories and subdirectories. For example, this again, and we see that so test 3 and test 4 are in the directory D1. We can also use the command list with the option T, which is short for 3, and it will use them in a more human friendly. Now the command ls can also take the name of subdirectory. For example, we will say list D1, then it will list only the content of directory D1. So with the command set, we set a specific password. We can generate a new password for an entry with the command gun, short for generic. For example, it shows the password that it has generated, and also it says it in this entry. Let's generate another password. This 16 is the length of the password. We want this many characters in the password, and this N option is no symbols. So it will only use letters and numbers, but not extra symbols like, for example, dollars or this. And it also detects that D1 test one already exists, so it asks whether we want to override. So it has generated the password with 16 characters. And let's try to override another entry, but we can use the option F or force so that it does not ask us override it or not, but just does it. For example, we have a password in this entry, D1 test 3. Let's generate a new one and override it. And with the option force, it will not ask us, but just override it. And again, so it now has the new password. Another command is mv, move, which is similar to the Linux command. So it takes an old path and a new path and moves or renames the old path to the new path. And it also has the option parse to rewrite the new path if it already exists. Let's move this entry to a new one, like test 6, for example. Rename it. So it has been renamed from test 5 to test 6. We can also rename or move directories, for example, from dir2 to dir3. The command copy, which is similar to move, but of course it retains the old copy as well. And also it has the option force if to override the new path if it already exists. For example, let's copy this one to the directory dir1. We have a new copy of this one. For example, let's check the content of D1 test file. And also let's check the content of D3 test 6. They are the same. It is just a copy of the first of this one. And now we have this text file, test file file here. And the command remove is similar again to the Linux command. We give the name of the file that is going to be removed. And if it is a directory, we can also give the option R recursive And since it always asks whether to remove it or not, we can also force removing so that it does it without asking. Let's remove this file. Let's try to remove this directory. So in order to remove the directory, since it contains some files inside, we have to use the option R recursively. Let's remove the directory D3 and all its content. Let's try another example with removing. We are going to remove again this directory that we just created by copying, and we give the options RF, recursive and force. We did it without asking. We can use the command edit to change the content of the password file. For example, each password file by default contains the password on the first line. But we may also need to add other information, for example, the username. And we add it on the second line or on the following lines, any of the following lines. Or, for example, the website where this password is used. So we can use the edit command, and it takes an argument, which is the file that is going to be edited, the password file. For example, let's edit this one. This one. And we see that there is only a password in this file, which is on the first line. So it is by convention, the password is almost on the first line. But we can add other lines on it. Let's check the content of this file. So the command show displays the content of the file. And when we just type the password file name, it shows us only the password. Now that we have some other information on the password files besides the password itself, we can use grep to search for this information. For example, it will list those files that contain this word that we are searching for with grep. So this password file contains also a line word. There is another command, find, which does not look at the content of the files, but at their name. Grep is for searching on the content of the files, and find is for searching by name, name of the file, and the directory where it is located. For example, so almost all the password files contain a test in their file name, so all of them are listed. But let's try another one, for example, find five. There are two password files that contain this pattern. B1 test 5 and test 5. Now this one is contained on the name of the directory. So these three entries are listed because the directory name contains this number that we are searching. The command log. The command log shows a list of the actions that we have done on the password, and also it has recorded also the time when it was done. So 4 minutes ago, we edited this one, and then 5 minutes ago we removed dir, and we started 19 minutes ago by adding a password for test, and then for test two, and so on. So all the actions that we have done, so far. Log command can also take a number which will limit the list of the logs that are displayed. It displays only the last 10 ones. Now to exit this shell, we can type the command Q. Type Q to exit. When we type password PW, it by default assumes that the name of the archive is PW. So it is the same as typing PW, but the same as typing this one. But we can also use another archive file. What are archive files? In this directory, we see that this is a file that stores the password. It is a archive file, TGZ, and it is also encrypted by GPG. This is a symmetric encryption with password, not an asymmetric encryption with private key and public key. So the default name of the archive is PW. If we don't give an archive name, that it will automatically open this one or try to open this one. But we can give another name for an archive, for example, and since this archive does not exist yet, it is trying to create it, and it asks for a password. And now this is an empty archive, it was just created. And if we check this directory, we see that this archive has been created. And also while we're creating the archive, it gives us this message, creating a new archive, and this is the path of the archive. Let's remove it. We can rename this archive to another one, and then try to open with the new name. For example, and if you try this command, then it will try to open this archive. So it is just the old archive, but we renamed it by changing the name of the file. And if we try to open, if we try the command PW without an archive name, then it will try to create a new one with a default name. Let's cancel it. In this directory, there is also a configuration file. And in this configuration file, we have the name of the default archive. If we change this name from PW to archive1, then whenever we give the command pw without an archive name, that it will try to open this this archive, archive 1, pw. So it is trying to open this archive. And this, the name of the directory where archives and configuration file is saved can also be changed. For example, let's move. So we are calling the command pw, but with this environment variable set to the directory where the archive files are located. And now it tries to open it to open the archive file from this directory. To make this change permanent, let's also export. So we are adding this line, we are appending it to .bash.rc. It is here on the end. And now to activate it, we should source the .bash.rc. And now, if we check pwd, environment variable, then it contains this directory. If we run pw, then it will pick up the name of the directory from the environment variable, pwd. So now we try to open the archive from this directory. So as I said before, this archive file is a directory that has been archived with tar, and is also encrypted. Let's check this. For example, we can decrypt this file with the command dpg. So it has decrypted it and created this archive file, tar file. We can open this archive file with the command tar. And let's open it on the directory. Let's make first a directory. It's empty. We can open it inside this directory. So it contains this the content that we see when we are in the prompt of the pw command. Now it is open. You see that there is also a git directory, because whenever we make changes to the structure of the directory, we also record a log line, a commit on it. And we can see what we have done. This thing that we did above, that we decrypted the archive and then we extracted the content of the archive to a directory file, can also be done with the command export. For example, pw, command export, where to export it to the directory It asks for the encryption password in order to decrypt it. And as exported the content of the archive to the directory. There is also a command for importing the content of a directory to an archive. For example, I'm making some changes manually to this directory, and then I will import it to a new archive, and then we will check the content of the archive from the password command, and we'll see that it is the same as that of the directory. Now let's import this directory to an archive with the name archive2. So the name of the archive is always before the command, and then comes the command import, and then the directory that we want to import. Since it is creating a new archive, it asks for a password, a new password. So we have now this archive, archive2. Let's check its content. So it is the same as the directory that we imported. It is the same content. We can also, in this example, in the last example, we imported to a new archive the content of the directory, but we can import it to an existing archive. And in this case, if there is a password entry with the same name, then the one that is being imported will override it. For example, let's change some entries in the temporary directory. And let's create temp 6 as well. Now let's import it to the default archive, which is archive1. I will import. And since we give no archive name, it will use the default one, and the name of the default archive is archive1. And now it asks, it is asking for the password of archive1. Let's open the archive1. We see the entries test 5 and test 6. The entry test 5 already existed on archive1, and the entry test 6, test 6 is a new one. So the new entry that we imported has overwritten the content of the existing one that was previously on the archive. So far, we always give the command pw, and we manipulate the archive entries from inside, from the prompt, pw prompt with the command. But it is also possible to give the commands directly on the command line. For example, pw ls lsp. Since we give no archive name, then it will assume the default archive, ask for the password of the default archive, which is archive1, and give the result of the command. For pw show, again, it will assume the default archive, ask for the password, and show the content of this entry. Is there another example? Okay, good. Now let's show the content of this entry. And we see that it has changed. The change that we made has been saved. Or, for example, let's remove. This. Let's use another archive, the second archive that we created this time. Archive 2. This. And it's asking the password for archive 2. It shows the listing. So it is becoming a bit tedious that whenever we give the password, whenever we give a command, it asks for the password. If we use public and private key or asymmetric keys with GPG instead, then the agent may save the passphrase for the key and then do the action automatically, decrypt it automatically. How to change asymmetric keys for encrypting the archives? We can use the command set keys, for example. Set keys actually can take some key IDs as parameters, but if we give no key ID as parameter, then it will create a new key, especially for this archive or for the password manager, and we'll use that one. Enter passphrase to protect your new key. So this is what it is doing. First, it is creating a new key since we did not specify an existing key. Thank you, Samuel. Enter it again. And after creating the key, it is trying to lock the archive with the new asymmetric key, but first of all, it needs to unlock it because it is already locked with the symmetric key, with a previous key. So before locking it with the second key, it has to unlock it first with the old key. So it is asking for the key to unlock the archive. Press enter to continue. Passphrase for the archive 2. So it unlocked it with the password that that was locked before, and now it has locked with the new key that created. This command keys is the shortcut for set keys, so it is the same as set keys. But since we did not give an archive, then it is working on the default archive 1. In this case, it does not need to create a new key because it can use the existing key that it created in the first case. So it just needs to unlock the archive with the old key, and then it will encrypt it with the new symmetric key. So it has locked it with the same key that the previous archive was locked. We see that for each archive that we have blocked with asymmetric keys, there is also an extra, has been created an extra file that specifies with which key it is locked. So the GPG keys is the key ID, and GPG home is .password.gnu.pg. So it is a special key that has been created for the password manager. And it says GPG keys because it can be locked with more than one key. Now let's try to open one of these archives. Second one, for example. So the first time that we try to access the archive, give a command for accessing the archive, it will ask for the passphrase of the private key that has been used to lock the archive. So after getting the passphrase for the first time, it will remember it. Actually, it is the NoPG agent that does this job, managing the keys and the passphrases. So it gets the passphrase and then caches it, and he knows it to use it for the subsequent uses, to use it again later. So let's try to open again. So no passphrase it is asking this time, but it doesn't mean that it is not encrypted. It is encrypted with an asymmetric key, but the passphrase of the private key is already cached by the GNOPG agent. And does PW. Again, it is encrypted with the same key, and so it knows how to decrypt. So this time, it does not ask for a password for the same reason that it knows the password and makes the usage of the password manager even easier. So no need to ask for the password. It is much more easier this time. But we should be careful if we copy. If we copy the archive to another home directory or to another computer, we should also copy these keys. And also, there is another directory hidden. So it is this directory which contains the keyring, the key that we created previously. So we should copy this one as well. It is possible to encrypt with more than one key, and for example, with two or three keys. And this is useful in cases where the same password archive needs to be used by more than one people. So if you want to share the password archive with somebody else, then he can create a GPG key, send you the public key, then you encrypt the archive with your own public key and with his public key, and then send a copy of the archive to the other person, and then both of you will be able to open the archive and to use the password archive. Okay.
Okay, Dasha, thank you very much for the presentation. Of course, for the more advanced users, it's very useful. However, where I think this is most needed is actually really like beginning users, including those in other systems like Windows, who really have lax security practices. Anything that you forgot and that you would like to add now, Dasha?
Yes, I would like to show something that I have forgotten on the presentation. It is a small thing. I don't know why it is broken the screen. Maybe I have increased too much the font. Okay, if we see, for example, the password for test 6. This is a long and complicated password. If, for example, we have to use this on a smartphone, it is impossible to copy it by reading and writing. And what can we do in this case is that we can save it as a QR. As a QR image, and then we can read it with a QR scanner. Right.
And how is this integrated into mobile apps then? Is it already available
in mobile apps? There are programs that are needed that can be used for reading QR codes, and you scan the code with the program, and then you copy and paste it from the mobile to.
Yeah, I see. Okay. So it's a bit manual.
Yeah, I have a mobile here, and then I have installed a QR code reader. I cannot show the screen of the mobile, sorry. And do you hear it recognized the code, and it also copies it on the I forgot it, not cache, on the clipboard. It copies it on the clipboard of the mobile phone, and then you can paste it wherever you need it. You keep it pressed, and then keep paste, and then it will paste it there. Okay.
Yeah. Clear.
Yeah. That's it for now.
Okay. So I have I wanted to show some things actually as well. So we discussed how good of random generation this software does. Can you tell us about that?
About what? Sorry, I couldn't hear you. Telling about what? About
random password generation.
Okay, random password. It is random passwords. For example. PW. So it is a long password of 20 or 30 characters, but we can also specify that we want it of 10 characters, for example. Or we can also say that we don't want. Funny characters, like for example plus just alphanumeric, making it alphanumeric. But if we want to use our own password, then there is a password pwgen that generates random passwords, for example, and we can select one of them. And usually these are passwords that can also be remembered easily. Anyway, we are using the password manager for saving them, so we don't need to remember them. But it is also easy to copy and paste them. Not to copy and paste, but to read and write. For example, I read it from the screen and write it on the mobile, for example, because they contain only alphanumeric characters. So this pwgen is a generic command. It is not related to pw password manager. For example, apt list pwgen. It can be installed with the package pwgen. It is a generic command. So I don't know whether I asked your question or you asked for something else.
We also previously discussed about random.org, which you said provides true random generated passwords, correct? Which is available on the web if you really need that kind of randomness.
Random.org. You don't need the randomness for a password. It can be anything or something that you can manage easily. But for managing passwords, you need a password manager, first of all. It is very difficult to manage it by remembering everything. It is impossible to remember everything, because you don't have just one or two or three passwords, but you have like 20 or 30 passwords at least. It is not a good idea to write them down as well, for two reasons, because they can be stolen easily, and also when you need it, you might not have the paper with you when you need a password. So it is not useful, but it is necessary to use a password manager, in my opinion, even for normal people, not just for system administrators or things like this. And password manager, PW, simple password, is one of these password managers. One option. There are other options as well, or other tools that can be used for this purpose.
Yeah, maybe for beginners, I could show the KeePass XC, which is another one, that people know that, the barrier to entry doesn't have to be very high, and that you can use simple tools as well. If I may, just one second, show.
Okay.
One second. If this will cooperate with me. It's not cooperating. For some reason, it's not allowing me to share the screen right now. So KeePass XC is another option. I'll put it on the chat. So there are several versions of KeePass, but this one is XC, is developed by the community, and it's recommended by certain organizations. And there you can generate random passwords. Of course, you can store them on your computer, and perhaps make a backup of that file as well, so that you have a backup of your passwords. So I would recommend that for beginners, and perhaps later on. Of course, I use pwgen as well. It's very handy and easy to generate passwords for your different needs. So I don't have any other. I also want to mention word combinations. Yes, thank you for posting that in the chat. Random word combinations. I don't know if this tool can do it. But if that's needed, there are different options. So basically, I'm referring to this AKCD I'll put it in the chat as well. This AKCD, XKCD, regarding password strength. And basically it says that if you're using a few random common words, memorable, it's almost as good as, random characters, which are very hard to remember and would work, and are actually even very difficult to type. So you exchange length of the password with the randomness of the character. Does your tool do this? Well, I'm calling it your tool, but does PW do this?
So I don't understand what is the point of this XKCD.
Basically it says that using longer passwords of common words is just as good as using random character passwords, which are, I don't know, 15 characters or something. So you would end up with
this is
30 characters, let's say.
But this is related to remembering the password. Yes, you can remember, you can find the password that is easy to remember and difficult to find out by the others. But how many of these passwords can you remember? Or it is not also recommended to use the same password everywhere? Because if a site is compromised or is broken and the usernames and passwords are leaked, then if someone finds your password with the same password, he will be able to log into all the other websites or services. So it is not recommended to use the same password for all the services or all the websites. So you can find a good password that is difficult to be cracked, and it is easy to remember. But how many of these passwords can you remember? I don't know. Can you remember 20 passwords? Usually, my list of passwords is 100 or even more.
The
list of services that I have to log in, I register here, I register there, and so on. It is a big list. And how many can you remember? So remembering a password is not an option. One password is okay. Yes. For example, the password manager, even if it is PW, the command line that I presented, or if it is KeePass X or something else, they need one password to allow you to log in. This is a good strategy for this password, for this master password, so that you can log in to the password manager and then access the other passwords. Yes. For one password, this would be a good strategy to use combinations of words. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Right. That in certain situations, this could make sense. But and also, if you're typing it across devices, it could make sense. But I agree that you end up in kind of the same situation if you're working with many passwords. So just to show, this is how a password would look like.
Okay.
If you don't have anything else to add, I guess we can close this session.
I want to add only this one that I forgot. The command line password manager that I presented might be good or useful for scripting, for example. If you have a script that accesses some resources and you need to use a username and password for this resource, you have two options, either to store the credential or the password in the script file. In this case, it is possible that you will upload the script file to some, for example, to GitHub, and it will be leaked. Or you can use a program, a command line password manager like this one, to retrieve the password from the password archive or archive, whatever it is. So
yeah.
this is one case where command line password manager might be useful, because you can use it in the scripts for scripting.
Yeah, right. Correct, right. All right, great. Thank you for the presentation, Dasho. And next, we'll continue at 12:30 with the workshop by Philippe Koval.